I'm very thankful for this man calling in every single Wednesday. His podcast is dynamite. And I am quite frankly thankful that there is a show called Good Morning Football that starts off NFL Network every day and is one of the most watched and relevant shows on TV. And we have a show like it on NFL Network. And one of the members of Good Morning Football, back here on the Rich Eisen Show, Kyle Brandt. How are you, brother?
I'm great to talk to you, Rich. I'm awesome. I'm thankful for you, too. Thank you for the kind words.
It's true.
I'm also thankful for your conversation with Justin Herbert relating to haircuts because, frankly, Rich, I really like it when you got any topic of hair. Mm-hmm. You and I once shared a dinner in which you shared your feelings with me about Brian Urlacher being a traitor to your kind.
Yes.
And I thought it was very funny. And so I'm into it, and I would have loved to have been there in studio with you for the Herbert conversation.
Well, you know what, Kyle? I appreciate that. And yes, this was, I believe, last year, right around Christmas time in Tampa, when you were there doing Good Morning Football prior to Bucks and Texans, and we had a fun dinner the night before where, and I told this to Urlacher's face that he is a traitor. Brockman has chimed in as well. The bald brother, he left us behind.
Left us behind.
He's a
traitor.
We don't take kindly to that.
Face of O'Hare Airport, Brian Urlacher. you cannot leave or enter the city of Chicago without seeing his face with the fake hair on billboards all over the airport. One of the billboards even says O'Hare, H-A-I-R Airport. You're probably just rubbing your nose in it, Rich. I'm sorry.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
Okay. Got it.
Not cool.
Oh, boy. So we just did Super Bowl mulligans to start this show because I'm getting mine ready for tomorrow's NFL game day morning.
Mm-hmm.
Would you take a mulligan on your preseason Super Bowl pick or no?
No, sir. Not in the AFC, my friend. The 10-0 Pittsburgh Steelers.
And who'd you have in the NFC then? Who'd you have in the NFC?
No, none. I took a lot of heat at the time, as you always do if you pick anybody in August other than the reigning AFC and NFC champions. Everyone said, oh, come on, Roethlisberger. He's, washed.com. You're living on planet delusional if you think Big Ben's going to come back from that. No way, no way. Not enough offense. Yeah, it looks pretty good. 10-0. Postponements aside, but
yes.
Nobody knew about Chase Claypool. Nobody knew how good Ben would be. I feel great there. Therein lies the rub in the National Football Conference, though, Rich. As we talked about early on in this season, I just went big. I went all in on the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, which I don't feel great about now.
Nope.
And yet, I don't love really anyone in the NFC. I think there's a lot of good teams. And if you're talking about a great team, like I don't see a Chiefs, I don't see Pittsburgh, even New Orleans. It's they're in a really strange position right now. And the team that I'm falling slowly in love with. Like we're just slow dancing. It's hands on the hips. We're playing Simply Red or something classy. I like the Rams.
I'm crushing
on the Los Angeles Rams.
While you were saying that, while you were going with your underwater, the fish under the sea dance sort of setup there.
Enchantment under the sea.
Enchantment.
I'm into it. I'm into the enchantment under the sea dance. Yes.
Because we were pointing at Mike Del Tufo, who got off of his Buccaneers pick prior to the season and jumped on the Rams to win the NFC. That was his mulligan. Very rarely do I point to Mike Del Tufo and say your thinking would be similar to his, let alone in terms of trying to sound expert on the subject of football. But their defense is frightening. It is Aaron Donald's team now, if you're looking for an identity. It's Donald in the front, Jalen in the back. Kind of like, a mullet, like a football mullet.
Yeah.
And then offensively, they didn't even need a run game to work. The games that requires apparently a run game to work off of on Monday night, man. I hear you.
It's the crazy thing about that game, too, is Aaron Donald was not in the stat sheet. Aaron Donald not only did not have a sack, he didn't have a tackle in the game.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not exaggerating. Cooper Kupp had more tackles than Aaron Donald for the Rams the other night, and they still won, and it didn't matter because he affects the game that much. So they have so many good players around him now that they don't rely on their defensive tackle to take over the game, and they can still win. And I would be remiss, Rich, if we're talking NFC, to bring up. I feel like I've got a pretty good sense now of the things that both of us and the guys find hilarious. And the fact that we're here in 2020 and somehow the comedian Gallagher is relevant. I mean, how awesome is this that Gallagher is the face of the Dallas Cowboys right now?
It was like late night VH1. Gallagher was always on
well,
VH1.
Well, here's I'm gonna keep pulling on this thread, Kyle.
Yes.
Kyle Brandt here on the Rich Eisen Show. That I do feel like Cowboys fans over the first 11 weeks of the season were actually draped in garbage bags because they were afraid of all the detritus that was going to be thrown upon them based on the sledgehammer that was the Dallas Cowboys season offensively and defensively. I do believe that there is already some similarity to the Cowboys season and the comedian Gallagher that fans had experienced, but did not actually, however, see that coming. Similar to, I think the last time a Super Bowl winning head coach brought up a pop culture reference nobody saw coming might have been when Belichick went Mona Lisa Vito on all of us during Deflategate. You know, like we didn't see that one coming. You know,
they were asking him to talk about, you know, the effect that cold weather has on inflation, and out of another galaxy, Bill Belichick said, "I'm not the Mona Lisa Vito of temperatures." Like, Bill, you've been sitting on that forever. And yet, listen, we've seen strange mascots, whether, you know, the rally monkey for the Angels.
Yes.
I remember at one point Pedro Martinez had a little friend that they referred to.
He definitely did.
Gallagher, of all things. And it just makes me wonder, like, will there be more friends? Like, if you're Mike McCarthy, you do the speech and you smash the watermelons and it works.
Yes.
What do you do as an encore? Like, what comedian from yesteryear do you break out? I have some suggestions.
Hold on a second. Kyle, before you do that, though, I think maybe before you get to the suggestions, I think you might want to work, if you don't mind me workshopping it before, is that instead of the same team pulling out other comedians from the past, that maybe in this wide open dumpster fire of an NFC East, maybe Joe Judge goes and gets Carrot Top for his own team and they do battle. And these older comedians do battle. Because I'm assuming
that's
one of the comedians.
That's how you one up Gallagher. You go and you get the John Lennon of prop comedy, Carrot Top. And that is if the Raiders aren't already using him because he's local.
Yes.
I think that would be great.
Yes.
I think if we're getting Gallagher up, I think you got to call I believe the gentleman's name was Jeff Dunham, who would have the grumpy old man marionette puppet or the ventriloquist puppet.
Or Terry Fader.
He's
also a ventriloquist.
Yeah, I think he's just down
and
the street, too.
Dunham, I think you find my guy, Yakov Smirnoff.
What a country.
And you talk to America's team. The motif fits perfectly. And then I think before Eagles week, you go to the legend and you say, if you're in the worst division of all time and you still can't win a game, you might be a Philadelphia Eagle. You go to the Fox. You go Foxworthy, and then you just run the gamut of these guys, and you go all the way to the Super Bowl.
So who knew, potentially, that the road to the Super Bowl went through Branson, Missouri? Who knew that that would be
Branson? That's right. That's the town.
I believe that's where Yakov Smirnoff might be seen right now, pre-pandemic. You go to Branson, Missouri, and you bring the family and you enjoy the Moscow on the Hudson comic stylings of Yakov Smirnoff. There you go.
Yeah, and if anyone doesn't know Yakov, he was sort of he had a little bit of a Borat shtick before Borat.
Oh,
and his whole thing was in Russia it's this, in America it's this, and he'd be like, America, what a country. You don't have tanks in your parade. You have Bullwinkle. I love this country. It was a great shtick for like a few years.
Now,
and he just killed
it. Can we bring out Lance Burton, too?
That he just chose a vodka and decided to make it his last name. But it worked. He's still doing it. He still owns the state of Missouri.
Yep.
And I got to tell you, Rich, a little promotional thing here on the network. I know tomorrow morning, Good Morning Football, we will be doing our de facto handoff to you guys.
Yes.
On our pregame coverage. I am going to be on my driveway tomorrow. We're doing a remote show, and I'm going to smash some watermelons in homage to Gallagher and the Cowboys.
Hell yeah.
You know what? I can't wait for that. But in all seriousness, Kyle, do you think McCarthy came up with this himself? I mean, what is the genesis of, you know what, trying to smash a watermelon, you know, Gallagher style to show everybody prior to this game coming off the bye in Minnesota that whatever the hell the analogy would come from it. I mean, Do we know where this came from?
It's a great question. And there's a follow-up question of, did he really think that anyone on the roster would resonate, that would hit home for them? I don't know if Leighton Vander Esch is familiar with Gallagher, but he went with it. And it strikes me as, Mike McCarthy, if we were to line up all 32 coaches, Rich, and say, which one is least likely to do a Gallagher prop humor with smashing watermelons? I think McCarthy might be the guy. This is the guy who used to show up for interviews, and you know, you would ask, hey Mike, we found this interesting thing in your background that you used to work as a toll booth operator before you got into
right,
football.
In Pittsburgh, yeah.
And he would say, yeah, you know, I don't actually think it's that funny. Okay, Mike, tell us about the Packers running game. He's a gruff dude, and yet he's smashing melons.
Oh my God! And Jerry Jones is like, I thought maybe you should have gone with a Sid Caesar joke, maybe, you know, like,
okay. Yeah.
The Cowboys long snapper is LP Leducier.
Yes. Oh, he's been at the league a long time.
He's 39. He's 39. So he is possibly the only one who knew Gallagher.
The long snapper got it. Yeah. I think is what he's
saying. Leducier has the What a Country VHS. He remembers the Showtime specials for Yakov Smirnoff and Jeff Dunham with the puppet. That's great. Okay, he's the guy.
He knows. He knows. And I bet I wouldn't be surprised if Andy Dalton was into Gallagher.
Sure.
No, Dalton's like, no, oh, please. Marvin Lewis did the Gallagher thing back in 1990. Whatever. I mean, come on. Marvin Lewis was all over Gallagher. Come on. Oh,
yeah,
my
Monty
God.
Kiffin loved Gallagher. He loved it. Big Gallagher guy.
Monty Kiffin. Fantastic. Yeah. Kyle Brandt here on The Rich Eisen Show. All right, brother. Scott Stapp. Look, you've had a lot of great celebrities on your podcast. You've got a lot of great celebrities on you. And you've done yeoman's work when you got someone like Tim Robbins on and nail it with all the pop culture reference. But this has to be, right? This has to be way up there for you so far for your podcast.
This is my Let It Be. This is why I got out of bed in the morning, to have Scott Stapp from Creed, who comes on, tells all the stories, completely self-deprecating, and has an awesome connection to the NFL. Scott Stapp, responsible for the iconic 2001 Thanksgiving Day halftime performance, a game in which I believe it was the Brian Greasy-led Broncos visiting the Ryan Leaf-led Dallas Cowboys.
Played
Higher, and they played their other songs, and he gets into all the details of the flying ribbon men and all the decorations, and he's wearing a number 11 jersey with Stapp on the back. I said, Scott, why is it 11? Was it a Drew Bledsoe or something? He says, no, it's 11. Because that's two ones put together, and that's how many number one hits we had at the time. And I was like, oh, Stapp, you are beautiful. He was so fun and so cool.
I was hoping his answer would be like a Spinal Tap answer, because that's where the volume went up to 11.
Turn it up when we're playing Higher. Yeah, he could have said that, but he went two number one hits, tells all the story of his recovery, Creed, how much he loves Aaron Rodgers, if he's willing to play a private concert for Kirk Cousins' birthday.
That's right. Oh, that's right.
He's a legend.
So how did you connect it? Because these are dots that you can connect yourself from your podcast guests, right?
Yeah. And at the end of every episode, we ask somebody, all right, so you've done the show. Call somebody out. Who should come on? Challenge them. You know, like one of these viral challenge styles. So, you know, McConaughey says, Woody Harrelson, come on here. And Aaron Rodgers says, James Holzhauer from Jeopardy, come on here. Well, Kirk Cousins, as we know, is an unabashed, proud Creed fan from day one. Right. And after Cousins came on at a great episode, he said, I want to have Scott Stapp come on here. I'm like, I don't know what Stapp's up to. I've never met him. I don't know if they're touring. Reach out to Stapp. He says, I'm in. He shows up, bangs out 90 minutes of premium stuff, and he was in. And he and Kirk Cousins may work out something for a private concert of my own prison for Kirk's birthday. I mean it. It's great.
You do know you got to get Gallagher on now, though, right? I mean,
I know. I mean, Gallagher, Rich, you're in this. Gallagher's a huge get right now. I don't know if anybody, people are. Trevor Oliver and Barbara Walters is competing for a Gallagher right now. He's hot.
And
I'd love to get him.
I got to tell you, Kyle. I mean, when Belichick dropped that Mona Lisa Vito reference,
I know.
Chris, was it the Thursday or the Friday before the Super Bowl? It was right before.
It was on the weekend.
No, Saturday. That's right. It was the Saturday before they were.
We had just landed in Arizona.
Right. So it was our first Super Bowl that we did for this show, along with DirecTV, and we had it all set up. And you've got the soundbite? Okay.
I'm not a scientist.
Oh, great.
I'm not an expert in footballs. I'm not an expert in football measurements.
He's pissed.
I'm just telling you what I know. Would not say that I'm Mona Lisa Vito of the football world.
Incredible.
As she was in the car expertise area.
Like, was he watching my cousin Vinny the night before?
Oh, God, like, just fantastic. So we immediately said, we have to get, even though, I mean, we had so much working, you know, so many moving parts. We had never done this before at a Super Bowl for our show. And you know, we had so many moving parts, and the guests were all lined up. We said we had to go get Marissa Tomei as a guest.
Oh, my God.
We had to get. So I immediately started calling people who knew her. I had run into her once or twice before. She wound up being, the only time she could do it was the first segment of our first ever Super Bowl show. So the first ever Super Bowl week guest in the history of this show was, in fact, Marissa Tomei, who said that her phone totally blew up out of nowhere, having no idea why. And her life basically for 48 hours went crazy because Belichick made that reference.
It's incredible. Oscar winner in that role. And you
yes.
opened the show with it. It's
yes.
That's a really amazing frozen moment, which I remember. And I only wish there was more. I wish that Belichick, when referring to the two gentlemen who inflate the footballs, referred to them as the two youths.
The two youths.
And said he takes pride in his grits. And that's how he knows how long it takes them to time the ball. He could have gone down a huge, huge wormhole for my cousin Vinny. And maybe he still has that in him. But you opening the show Super Bowl week with the Oscar winner,
it was
Mona
great.
Lisa Vito, it's an all-timer.
It was great. And I'm wondering, Gallagher's phone must have blown up wherever the hell that was. We could ping him in Branson, Missouri.
Yeah, see, I wonder, though, like, Gallagher, not exactly maybe the ideal radio guest. I'm going to kind of need the visual for Gallagher. I need the zoom yes. for the watermelon.
Describe for me the fruit exploding.
Gallagher is 74, and I think he's retired in Idaho.
There you go.
Yeah, I know he's got takes, too. There was a time when Comedy Central named their top 100 stand-ups of all time, and Gallagher was literally number 100, and he didn't think it was funny. He was pissed. He starts naming people in front of him and says, I never heard of this guy. I'm Gallagher. Like, he has
yes.
takes. So maybe I take it back.
So somewhere up around Redfish Lake, in the 2 seconds that the mm-hmm. That the 5G kicked in and his phone could actually get some sort of reception, it buzzes like, what the hell's going on with the Dallas Cowboys?
Amazing.
And it worked. It worked. They won the game. It worked. It
actually... You got to keep doing it.
Somebody, Jerry Jones, is somebody go down to the supermarket and get me some more
Rich
melons.
Jerry was on. He was on GMFB this morning, and we said,
"Did you?"
So what do you think of it, Jerry? And Jerry, would you be willing to swing the mallet yourself,
and?
Personally? And, you know, he did his thing. If it means we're going to win games,
that's
I'm
right.
more than healthy to help out. So he said, yeah, I'm game. Spit in his hands, rub it together, and smash the melon.
Somebody go to the Arlington shop right and buy up all the honeydew. Thanks for the call, Kyle. Happy Thanksgiving. I'll chat with you, I guess, in the morning when your show hands off to from Good Morning Football to NFL Game Day morning. You're the man. Really
Absolutely,
appreciate it.
Absolutely, sir. I am leaving right now to go to the supermarket to find watermelons, and I'm not kidding. I'll be smashing them tomorrow.
I'm not kidding.
Cannot wait.
Please take a photograph of the cart. Okay, take a photograph of the cart.
Are your kids going to be outside?
Pumpkin pies and sweet potatoes. There's one idiot buying 12 watermelons in November. That'll be me.
You're like Flounder in an Animal House. I'll take 10,000 watermelons, please.
That's me.
10,000
like, hanging
kiwi?
Up and going. I gotta get a watermelon.
All right, take Thanks, it easy. Take it. There's Kyle Bryant, everybody.
See you,
oh, my gosh. That was funny. Hey, you watched all the way to the end. Thanks for that. Watch more right here.